Hello, my name's Josh Bull and I'm a mathematician. So I work in mathematical modeling, which is where we try to convert problems in the real world, the non-mathematical world, into a mathematical language and use our models to predict what's going to happen. So for me, usually that's working in biology and in cancer research. We try and encode our understanding of the biology into some maths and use that to make predictions. But today I'm going to talk about a slightly different problem, which is how can we apply this to football? So in particular, a few weeks ago, somebody knocked on my office door and said, "Josh, I need to know who's going to win the World Cup. Please, can you tell me?" So we said, "Let's build a model." So I'm going to tell you today, my process as a non-football expert of going in and trying to build a predictive model. And that kind of mirrors the way that mathematicians build these models every day. So let's see, where do we start? So we're interested in working out who's going to win the World Cup. We've got a 1 in 32 chance of being right, I think. So that's, not bad odds to start off with. But we can do better than that. We can predict basically every game that's going to be in the World Cup. We're going to take them and see who I think is going to win. And at the end of that, I'm going to write down the winner of the World Cup. And then I'm going to check whether that winner is England, which, will be a good reality test for whether the model's working or not. And assuming that it is coming home, I'll repeat this process many, many times. So the key thing is we don't just do this once because this is a very noisy game. Anything can happen in football. It's a funny old world. But if we do this 10,000 times, 100,000 times, and we start to see the same team coming out on top, then maybe we can say, yes, definitely going to be England. So how do we go about simulating the tournament? Well, a wise man who I've forgotten to write down in this presentation once said, "A journey of 1,000 miles begins with a first step." And as we all know, a tournament of 64 games begins with Qatar versus Ecuador. So let's take this one at a time. Forget about simulating the whole tournament. How do you predict who's going to win a football match? Is it just a coin toss between Qatar and Ecuador? Or can we use the information about which of these teams is better to make a prediction? I think the answer is yes. And I think one of the best tools for doing this is something called XG, which is very popular in football modeling circles. So what is XG? Well, XG is a measure of how likely a shot is in a football match. If a footballer takes a shot, what were their chances of scoring it? So this is a good measure for saying whether they were likely to score a goal or not. And it's great at kind of reducing some of the noise that you often get in football matches. So sometimes a player might score a goal, but they kicked it from the halfway line. The chance of it going in was 1 in 100, and they just got lucky. And sometimes a team might do everything right and yet just, be really unlucky on the day and not get any points. But there's still quality, and maybe if they played that match again, you'd see a different result. So what XG does is, as a simplified form, it says, given where that player was and they take the shot, how likely were they to score? So if you're very close to the goal where this little yellow thing is, you're much more likely to score than if you're taking a shot from further out or from further away from the goal. So this can, broadly speaking, give us a very rough measure of how likely a given shot was of going in. And we can add up all of the shots that are taken within a game by the England team, say, and we can look at how often they go in. So this is from the big Ipswich versus Portsmouth match a few weeks ago. And you can see that the actual score was 3-2 to Ipswich. But when you add up all of the XG here, Ipswich had 2.47 expected goals, and Portsmouth got 1.71, including two penalties, which you can make your own judgment on the relative quality of these teams. I will remain unbiased here. So the important number for predicting what this match would look like would be to look at this total XG that's scored in this match. And we can say, well, okay, maybe 3-2 wasn't such an unlikely scoreline. Maybe if this had been 5-0, we'd have said, yes, that's a bit unlikely, but it could still happen. So what we need is a way of going from this kind of predicted XG for the team to the score of a football match. And the way that we can do that is by using a Poisson distribution. So this fancy graph that I'm very proud of because I managed to get footballs into Matplotlib. Love it. This graph shows basically for a given XG, how many games will have a certain number of goals. So at the moment, we're looking at quite high numbers. If my team has an XG of around 6.5, then I'm expecting to see 6 goals scored by that team in as many as 20% of the games. And you can see as the XG goes up, the total number of goals that that team's expected to score is going to go up as well. But obviously, you can't score half a goal. So this is really telling us, if we look over a lot of matches, this is what we're expecting to happen a certain number of times. So low XG, in most games, there'll be very few goals scored, but occasionally it's going to be higher. And the Poisson distribution turns out to be a good way of modelling this. There are other assumptions that you can make. And this is a key thing in the process of mathematical modelling, is you make assumptions and you see what happens. And if that gives you believable results, then you say maybe they were good assumptions. If something goes wrong, that tells you where you can revisit and change what you're doing. So, back to Qatar versus Ecuador, the big game. Well, on average, if I just look at every international match that Qatar has played in the last 4 years, I know that on average they score 1.69 goals. That's their XG. Ecuador, on the other hand, 1.4 XG. So, I can use our Poisson distribution, sample from two different Poisson distributions, and end up with loads of simulated scorelines. And I'm going to put them in a funky heat map, which basically shows, what the expected distribution of the score lines is. So you can see here, the most common score here would be 1-1. But there's maybe a few more goals, a few more matches where Qatar is scoring more than Ecuador. And I can say that on average, under this model, Qatar are likely to win this about 45% of the time, whereas Ecuador are only winning maybe 30% of the time. So this is great. This gives us a way of simulating a match. So let's go ahead with this kind of very simple model and see what happens with the World Cup. So I can see who I think is going to get through the group stages from just running one particular iteration. And yeah, I'm not going to narrate all of this, but you can kind of have a lot of fun watching the model kind of do some likely or unlikely matchups before we get to the big England versus Qatar final. And by sheer chance, the simulation that I happen to use for this one has an England victory, which, maybe it's just fate. I definitely didn't fudge that at all. So if I do it 100,000 times, unfortunately, England dropped down the list a bit. And you can see here that Germany and the Netherlands do very well here, which we might expect. But it is a little bit suspicious, right? Because England are down here just below Iran, and Japan are right up the top. Japan are winning the World Cup about 6.5% of the time, according to this model. This doesn't seem very likely, right? So we say, well, okay, when our model is behaving in a way that we think is probably not realistic, that's maybe a sign that we're making bad assumptions. And the assumption that I'm going to look at here is the idea that I can predict what England's XG will be by just averaging what they scored in every previous international match. That's their XG, sorry, not their actual goals. And I've been looking at the last 4 years. But this maybe isn't a good way of kind of predicting this, because obviously the XG isn't just a property of a team. It's a property of who they're playing. If I'm playing against a really, really strong opposition and I don't get very many shots, I'm going to have a very low XG. Whereas if I'm playing against very weak teams that maybe don't defend as well, maybe I can get incredibly high XG despite not being a good team. And that's exactly what you see when you look into the data. So, for instance, Japan, who were coming out very highly in our model, have had several matches like this. Mongolia versus Japan, where they managed to win by a colossal amount of goals, racking up an XG of 5.02, which is pretty huge. Whereas England have had some tougher matches. So, for instance, playing Italy in the Euro 2020 final. Everyone will be a little sad. Well, I say everyone, but maybe not the Italians, to see that actually Italy probably deserved the win there. They scored twice as much XG as England did. But on the whole, we don't want to say these matches are comparable. You know, England scoring 0.9 XG against one of the strongest teams in the world is probably not the same as Japan scoring 5 XG against Mongolia. So maybe we don't want to just kind of crudely average these things and say, yes, Japan are a better team than England are. So I want to look at a way of measuring the relative strength of teams. And something which is very convenient is that this already exists out there. So what I want to do is scale the XG that each team is getting according to the strength of their opponents. And we can measure that. And I'm going to use this website, eloratings.net, where basically they've been tracking football ratings for a very long time. And you can go through and see exactly how they rank each football team on the international stage against one another at any given time in history. And this is based on the way that that chess players are rated. You know, if a strong chess player loses to a weak chess player, they drop down the rankings. And it's exactly the same here. You get points for beating people that are stronger than you, lose them for losing to people that are weaker than you, or whatever way around that makes sense. So we can look at these ratings and assign a team strength to each team. And it turns out when you do this, you get some very pretty pictures. So what you're seeing on the bottom here is the home team rating. So the further towards the right we go, the stronger the home team is. Away team rating on the vertical axis, the further towards the top we are, the stronger that team is. So if we're in this kind of top left quadrant, can you have a top left quadrant of half? I don't know. In this kind of top half, the away team is stronger. In the bottom half, the home team is stronger. And you can see that the way I've coloured these points is according to the difference in the XG between those teams. So if we see a red colour, that means the home team racked up more XG in that match than the away team, vice versa for a blue colour. So conveniently, you can see if the away team is very strong and the home team isn't, the away team scores more XG. That's kind of what we expect. This is a good sign. But you can also see it looks like it's making a very nice pattern indeed for us. And in fact, if I plot the difference there, the home XG minus the away XG, against their rating difference, we get a lovely straight line. So this basically gives us a way of saying if team A is 500 ELO points stronger than team B, we're expecting them on average to finish the game with 1.8 more XG or something along those lines. So this is a nice simple way of converting from the rating difference between two teams to the XG difference that we're expecting to see in there. So what I'm going to do now is adjust these previous XGs, the ones that I've put in my model since 2018, and I'm going to adjust them based on the rating difference between our teams. And you can see coming back to Qatar versus Ecuador, this makes quite a big difference. So Qatar's expected XG has dropped down to 1.16, whereas Ecuador have gone up a bit to 1.57. And suddenly, when we simulate this game many, many times, we see that actually Ecuador are more likely to win, up to 45%. Qatar are down at 30%. So the tables have completely turned. And we can return to our entire tournament, and we see that we get something that's a little bit more believable to the average football fan on the street. So at the top, teams like Brazil, Argentina, Netherlands are expected to do very well. And teams like Japan have dropped quite a long way down our predictions, down our rankings. So much more believable. And we're done. Right? Hang on a minute. We're not done. Why 2018? Well, I chose 2018 for the very scientific reason that this is when England suddenly became good at football. And that's probably not a good date to measure from. You know, that's very arbitrary. And actually, a lot of football fans will be keen to tell you that form is incredibly important and that the way a team has performed recently will be more predictive of what's about to happen. Certainly when it comes to international football, maybe the teams look very different now to how they looked 4 years ago. So it's probably a reasonable thing to say that more recent results should be more important when we're making our predictions than results from 2, 3, 4 years ago. So I'm gonna weight our results differently so that the more recent that result is, the more credibility we're giving to it when we calculate our averages. And when I include this kind of time decay, actually we end up with something quite similar again. You get a bit of shuffling. England are above Uruguay, which is probably good. Let's hope that that happens. But we're still not far enough up this table for my liking, and that whether that means we should challenge some assumptions, I'm going to. And in fact, what assumptions could we change? Well, there is something that we've been glossing over quite a lot. We're changing the XG from previous matches based on how different the team ratings are, but I'm not actually using that. So I'm calculating what I think the XG is going to be for a given team, and I say Qatar's XG on average is 1.4. And so I say they're likely to score 1.4 goals per game, whether they're playing Brazil or whether they're playing Ghana. So that's probably not good. We probably want to be adjusting our matches based on who they're playing rather than just based on who they've played in the past. And in fact, if we come back to this nice straight line that we saw earlier, well, we can just sample directly from this. You know, if we have a 500-point rating difference between the teams, why don't we just sample that they should have an XG difference of 1.8 or whatever this red line is? And in fact, this is a lovely normal distribution around this line. And so, in fact, we can not only take the mean value, but we can also add that noise in and get a sense for the kind of width of this distribution here. And in fact, we can personalize this for each team. So we can look at each team and see, on average, when they play an opponent who is stronger or weaker than them, what do we expect this XG difference to be? And this seems to be quite a nice, simple model that is quite good at predicting the data that we can see in the past, at least. And you can see here, this gives us a very similar ordering in terms of Brazil, Argentina, Netherlands, Spain. The teams that we think are likely to be good are up at the top. England still depressingly low in this model. But we can use this then to actually look at what we think the most likely outcome of the tournament is. So the way we're doing this is for each match, just to be clear, we're looking at the ratings difference according to eloratings.net. I'm going to use that to predict the difference in XG between those teams, and I'm going to sample from some distribution with that mean and variance. And when I do that, that will say, for this version of Qatar versus Ecuador, we're expecting Ecuador to be 0.3 XG ahead. And then I'm kind of doing some fudging based on their previous XG values to kind of scale them so that I get the difference that I'm expecting to see. So there's a bit of fudging going on in there. And I then sample from those two Poisson distributions for those given XGs to get the right score, or the predicted score. And again, we repeat this a lot of times. And this is what comes out. So this is, my prediction, my future in sports modelling on the line. My model is basically saying that Brazil are definitely looking most likely to win, but by no means guaranteed. So it's putting them at around 15% of my simulations. They've come out on top. And what you're seeing here really is just showing who I think the two teams who appear in the final most often are, the four teams in the quarterfinals and so on. So I'm not saying that I think this set of matches is the most likely lineup. I don't actually know if it's possible to get these matches given the group stages. But we will see. So you can see that England at least are favoured to make it out of the groups in 60% of the simulations. And actually in this model, they are quite close as we go further and further through. So, you know, we're maybe not completely out of the running yet. Hang on, stop the press. One more change, one last minute change to our model that we can make. So we've not included the FCH factor at all. So the FCH factor is a technical mathematical term for those who aren't familiar with it. And this is a value which scales the England team's XG based on whether or not football's coming home. And you can see that the FCH factor only needs to be about 1.7 in order for England to top the table. So, you know, it's not unlikely.